the most famous berg around. Not Iceberg, not Landsberg, unfortunately. Today on OTR, the WCW's massive superstar and the man you told us you wanted. Today on Off the Record, we deliver Goldberg.
Michael Landsberg, brought to you by the Keg Steakhouse and Bar.
How am I doing?
Well, you're making this really difficult for me, aren't you?
I'm making a fool of myself. Great to welcome you to the show today. And again, we talk about it all the time. We talk about delivering the guests that you want. And for, I guess, about a year now, you have asked for this guy. Former Atlanta Falcon, that's relevant today. Great to welcome the former champion of the WCW and maybe the most popular guy on the planet right now, Bill Goldberg. Nice to see you, man.
Good to be here.
Great to welcome back to the show. I got to say, I love this guy on the show because he would speak out, not just on wrestling stuff, but great sports knowledge all across the board. Respect him, though, because he's a great broadcaster, Mean Gene Okerlund today. Good to see you.
Thank you very much, Michael. Your check is in the mail. And alluding to the popularity of Mr. Goldberg, I would have to say without any question of a doubt, he is the most popular Jewish athlete in the world today, with the possible exception of Monica Lewinsky. Just kidding.
That's a sport. You have opened up a whole can of worms here.
I hope so.
And great to welcome back to the show as well our resident, to some extent, wrestling expert. He is the host of Live Audio Wrestling, Fan 590 talk show host, Jeff Merrick, today on Off the
Michael,
Record.
Thanks for having me. Number one talk show in Canada. Glad to be here.
Not your show. You mean my show.
Off the Record.
Okay, I wanted to clarify that. Okay. Today, candid discussion about pro wrestling build, now not as sport, but entertainment. And what happens when sport, real sport, fails to protect society from the monsters it creates. Like Mike Tyson, back in jail for assault. This could be the end of the road. Gotta ask you guys, who come from a very violent world, at least two of you, should the judge have taken Tyson's comments and life in the ring into account when it was time to sentence him?
Absolutely. What a man does at work should be kept distinct from what he does at home or in his public life. There's no way that, I don't think you can correlate the two. I don't think it's right to correlate the two.
On the subject of Mike Tyson, of course, he brought new meaning to the phrase, bite me. But I would have to say this, that he was on probation. And the way things are done in the States, judicially, he did break the law. A little fender bender down in Maryland.
Gene, don't recap the thing for
no,
us.
But
let's get to the heart of the matter.
The question is...
Just let him recap.
Wait a minute.
I don't know the situation.
You don't know the Mike Tyson
no,
situation?
No, I've been on the road, unfortunately, being arrested.
On the road, so like in parts unknown?
That's where I'm from.
Okay.
Better than truth or consequences.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah. No, but I think he probably is where ultimately he'd ended up. This guy should really be put into a mental hospital, and you got to bring him around to the ways of society.
Here's the question, Bill. Bill, okay to call you Bill?
Yeah.
Okay. The question is with Mike Tyson, and Jeff says no. The question is, when you go to sentence him for a crime, he assaulted a couple of guys and pleaded no contest. When you go to sentence him, is it fair to say, I'm going to punish you a little bit more harshly than I would have because you bit another man's ear in the ring, because you made comments about killing other people in the ring? Is that fair? And I don't think it's fair. I don't think it's relevant. It's his job.
I don't think it's fair, but, each circumstance is different, no question about it, with me not knowing a lot about what happened. But no, I don't think it's fair to judge him as he is, how he is in public, because of what he's done in the ring, no.
Absolutely, and moreover, how do you know? Just because the way a certain man conducts himself in his profession, that's no reason to say, well, since he behaves this way in the ring, therefore
he's like this in public. Wait a minute, Jeffrey. Here, just a second. The way this guy behaves in the ring is one thing, which I thought it was in poor taste the last couple of matches that he's had anyway. But here's a guy that needs to be rehabilitated. He cannot function in society.
We're not arguing that. Absolutely, I agree with you.
But are you saying because he's a great boxer that he should be able to get away with this kind of chicanery?
I think it's outlandish for a judge to say because you bit a man's ear off in the ring, because you behave this way at work, therefore you deserve an extra punishment.
He was on probation. He broke the law, he got out of a fender bender, and KO'd a couple of guys. You can't do that.
Okay, let's make it a little more personal then. Say you're in court, And
I've been there before.
We see you every week, kind of stirring it up, starting a fight, provoking something every now and then. Do we take that into account as well?
I've got good lawyers. From Goldberg's firm.
You bring up a good point, though. I mean, this is the guy's job. This is what he does. And I mean, you guys, of all people in the whole world, should not make the leap from saying what he does in the ring to what he does outside it. Okay.
I can say that. I don't think Mr. Goldberg would say that, as he is probably these two gentlemen have sided with you on the Tyson matter.
All right. Let's bring it up to, let's talk some post-Super Bowl memories and an issue that we've debated on this show. We don't give a damn who's the better team. We talk about the issues that come from it. Eugene Robinson, the guy who got caught the night before, at least allegedly still at this point.
I don't know where they can get something like that for 40 bucks.
Is there anything you take seriously?
Nothing.
Okay. Eugene Robinson, did we, as the media, treat him unfairly because we look for a story, or did his friends treat him unfairly because they said, hey, give the guy a break? Where do you guys stand on it?
Ooh. Being a former teammate or a former member of the Atlanta Falcons, it's going to be hard for me to answer this one. But I think he made a huge mistake, period. I think that he opened himself up to the ridicule from the press. I mean, they're looking for something like that, especially Super Bowl time. And his teammates made it worse altogether.
How did they make it worse? I'm interested.
Well, to think that he's above what he did, especially at that time, I think in that respect they made it worse. Also, the fact that just by touching on it, minute after minute, every conversation they had, every press conference, that was definitely the topic. And as opposed to saying no comment.
So you think they should have said no comment?
Everybody had an opinion.
Gene?
Eugene Robinson was a distraction for the Atlanta Falcons. He was a hypocrite because he was a God-fearing, Bible-reading member of that team. And he did something that certainly society judged as being immoral. The league took umbrage to what he did, and I think his teammates gave him, as Billy alluded to, I didn't mean to call you Billy, I'm sorry about that, Goldberg.
That's all right.
Yes.
You apologize for calling him Billy?
Well, he doesn't like Billy. And he doesn't like Goldie, he likes Goldberg. Did I answer the question about Eugene Robinson?
I think you did to some extent. But, you know, you guys are, you know, everybody's sensitive to Eugene Robinson, who plays in that world to some extent. But not sensitive to Mike Tyson. We don't know Mike Tyson. He wasn't a teammate. How about a guy like Kevin Green? He was your roommate, right? Kevin Green? He got into a little scuffle on the sidelines. Would you hold that against him? Would you hold that against him if he went to court, say, and he got in trouble and say, hey, the guy's a loaded cannon?
You know, you have to keep in the back of your mind, obviously, especially with Tyson, you know, something as violent as what he's done. But then again, you can't judge them on it. You have to keep in the back of your mind. You have to understand what they've done and what they're capable of doing. But then again, I don't think it plays part in the process, due process.
All right, on that note, we will take a break. Not with Billy, not with Goldie, but with Goldberg from the WCW, me and Gene Okerlund and Jeff Merrick. We will return to talk, well, we won't talk about this quite yet. Wrestling later on in the show. When we return, how much is too much in hockey? He is Goldberg. He's Mean Gene Okerlund. He's Jeff Merrick. I'm Michael Landsberg. This is Off the Record. Mean Gene entertaining us through a commercial. Let's get serious now, though.
Yes.
Let's talk about Brant Myers, tough guy for the San Jose Sharks. He was mad that one of his teammates kind of got slashed and there was no penalty. So what he decided to do was, as you guys do, I mean, you take it to the sidelines. He took it to the other team's bench, climbed in, and tried to even things up that way. I want to ask you guys, if you were the league, and this is taped in advance, so the penalty may be handed down, would you suspend him or would you throw him out for good?
You just have to suspend him. It's just about appearances. Let's face it, the NHL, on the surface, pretends that they don't like this kind of stuff. However, everyone in that arena was popping like the corks out of champagne bottles. Let's face it, it sells.
I would have to definitely agree with suspension. If Brian Burke were still with the league today in his official capacity, vice president in charge of rules and regulations, whatever he did, I'm certain that Brian would agree suspension. But I think it should be a pretty harsh suspension, maybe 10 games without pay.
Don't you think it's kind of hypocritical, though? I mean, the NHL, in a sense, turns a blind eye to a lot of this and says, yeah, you know what? It happens. Let's pretend that it's not really a big deal because it's selling a lot of tickets. And
it
then to turn around and sort of feign surprise when we
what
see
it. Does.
It. Sure. And to pretend that we're shocked when it happens. It happens every couple weeks. And so, you know, there's a 5-game suspension or a 10-game suspension. It's just window dressing, isn't it?
I think you suspend the guy for good and have him become my new tag team partner.
You like that attitude, don't you?
I like his attitude, most definitely.
It must have been weird for you, though, to... You went from a sport that has rules. It says you can't do anything to now entertainment slash sport where there are no rules. So what he's doing and what you do...
Is legal.
You know, encouraged.
I'd get thrown in jail for doing some of the things that I do now if I was still playing for the Falcons, no question about it. But you got to draw the line somewhere.
Sure. All right. So where do you draw the line when it comes to the law? When it comes to throwing a guy in jail for something that he does? There's an issue that has come up. Yes, in sport, because I'm going to show you something, and I want you to tell me whether or not. Let's roll the video on this. Watch what the player does. He takes his stick, and he goes like this in another player's face. Now, this is the West Coast Hockey League. Now, what I want to ask you guys is, the law has come on and charged him with assault. This is the melee afterwards. Takes his stick, sticks it in the face of another guy. They come on and say, hey, that crosses all boundaries, that's illegal, and they press charges. Does the law, does the police have any place on the ice?
I think they have in the past.
Mm-hmm. I'm not asking whether they've done it in the past. I'm asking your opinion. Do they have a place?
Well, I think it's going to have to be up to the Western Hockey League or the Ontario Hockey League.
I'm asking
League.
You, what's your opinion? Should the law step onto the ice?
I think they have to, take care of their own house.
I'm asking you, should the law step on the ice?
Absolutely not.
I agree with Gene, and for that specific instance, that was a lot worse than... That was a lot...
It looked worse than it was.
That's what I'm trying to say. It looked worse than it actually was. The guy got scratched, the guy who got stick. He got scratched. He even finished the game, and that stick in the face was a retaliation for something he did a few games
before.
Bill,
is there anything a guy can do in a football field, in a hockey rink, not going into the crowd I'm talking about here, I'm talking to another player, that the law should come in and say, uh-uh, we're charging you?
No, I don't think so.
Nothing, no matter what?
I don't think so. You know, being a member of the NFL for a number of years and now doing what I do and having friends all around the league in NHL, NBA, whatever it may be, I don't think so.
Because yeah, they're your friends, though. Doesn't mean that they should be able to escape legitimate punishment.
I think they should police their own sport.
And if
That's
they don't?
If they don't, then they should be reprimanded.
This is unlike, Michael, the Tyson incident, which took place out in society. It did not take place in a ring. It did not take place on a playing field. It did not play on a basketball court. It happened at an intersection of Walnut and Vine.
Oh, I don't think anyone's going to say that, yeah, well, an athlete should be above the law no matter where he is. But the issue is, should an athlete be above the law when he plays a sport? If a tennis player hops over the net and beats the crap out of the other guy,
that's
can you say ratings? I mean, lays a beating on him, knocks him unconscious. And that's not accepted in a sport, should that guy be charged?
The reason that doesn't happen with something like tennis is that it's because they do police their own, and they have certain guidelines, and it's a zero-tolerance policy. And until sports like hockey or football accept that kind of responsibility,
okay, the guy does that. He hops over the net. Help me out here. Would you charge him? He goes across, and he beats the daylights out of the other guy with the racket. Would you charge him?
I got the little Brit sitting up in the chair. He says... point, and they throw it to the other guy.
For that, I think for that sport you have to. It's not a violent sport. Right. You can understand how absurd violence spills over in sports like football, like hockey, where there is contact.
I'm not so certain that it doesn't sell tickets in tennis too, Jeff.
I would watch tennis more. It's no secret.
I don't know why it is, but when you're on the show, me and Gene Urkel and I tend to want to talk a little bit deeper. We're going to take a break, and when we do, we're going to talk to this man beside me, Bill Goldberg, and these two about what he does so incredibly well, wrestling and some of the issues. How's that? When we return. Attitude. The WWF sells itself about their new attitude. Two distinct styles, obviously very much successful, both of them. The WWF and the WCW, but very different styles. In the WWF, it is about this kind of thing, hardcore, blood and guts, and trying to push the envelope, as they say. Women with short or no skirts slapping each other around. That is what the WWF is doing. This is more classic wrestling. Hollywood Hogan showing off his muscles, this kind of stuff. I want to ask you guys, what do you think about the guys across the hall from you and what they're doing? Gene?
There's a whole new ball game, by the way, in Canada. The absence of World Championship Wrestling. We're going to be back on the 29th of March at Air Canada Centre. I got to get that little promo.
Life is just one big promo,
yes.
Isn't it?
However, we just have not been able to do what they're doing because we have to adhere to family values, as it were. We're part of a big corporation. I'm not saying what they're doing is wrong. Certainly, it is a rating success. However, there's no place for us in that particular ball game.
Yeah, you know, I have to agree with that. I even if there was place for us in that game, I can't honestly say that I would take part in it. What we do is provide a product for the kids out there, you know, and what they do turns the kids off, as far as I'm concerned. Turns the parents off.
Doesn't turn the kids off. It turns the kids on. Raw is arguably, and I mean, there are more teenagers that watch Raw than any other show, regardless of anything.
But for the parents out there, it should make them turn it off. That's the point I was making.
At the same time, you're starting to see a lot more WWF-influenced moments on Nitro. Bam Bam Bigelow with Jim Fullington. With the barbed wire, you guys are starting to do a lot more skits now.
Oh, please!
You're going
so
heavy
we,
with
Jeffrey,
the funny.
That, we've been doing that for 3.5 years.
Certainly true, but
we
I mean, you're doing
in
a lot
a
more
of,
now.
Of teams from ECW that were quote hardcore.
But you never had hardcore matches.
There's a difference between hardcore and vulgar.
And you consider what the WWF does as vulgar as opposed to the barbed wire.
Listen, whenever it involves kids, 6 to 11, that's they're forming. Opinions, or they're getting some emotionality. You've got to be sensitive to those needs.
Let's talk about the war that exists between the two. And sometimes it's actually, you know, outside of the different styles, it's quite interesting and can be quite entertaining and can raise the entertainment value. Two things. One time you guys on your broadcast leaked out the fact that Mick Foley was going to win the title, which is an interesting way to try to prevent the audience from going over. And of course there is their now famous Gilbert. What do you think of that?
Oh, well, actually this is the first time I've seen it.
Okay.
To be honest with you. And, I think it's a joke, but then again, it's the most sincere form of flattery. That's how I look at it.
It's gonna make you bigger. It's gonna make you. I'm serious. This is a short-term funny, but it's a long-term stroke for you, Bill.
Short-term funny. I'd like to see him stand on my pyro. He'll ignite like a wick. But
he'll ignite like a wick.
I, as you can tell, I'm.
Are you mad?
Very much opposed to it.
Right. Does it make you mad?
It makes me mad, but you know, it doesn't bother me. There are a lot of things that make me mad that I don't act on.
I'd like to explore that semantically. It makes me mad, but it doesn't bother me.
It makes me mad, but it really doesn't bother me.
Do you understand
me.
That,
It doesn't,
Jim?
Doesn't take a lot of my time up.
I understand. I understand that.
But that's good, clean fun, right? That doesn't cross the line of what's acceptable.
You're saying
they cross the line in other areas. You're cool with this, right?
You know, here's where they cross the line. I don't care about the gals. I mean...
But let's talk about the Gilbert thing.
Yeah. Well, I don't know if they're crossing the line there. My goodness, they had the Huckster, and they had the Nacho Man, and they had Mean Gene, or Scheme Gene, and how they ever got that is beyond me. But these things, that's kind of when the momentum turned around, and WCW with Nitro became the big hit.
What I really liked about the Monday Night Wars 2 years ago that I don't like now, the Monday Night Wars originally made both you guys better products, WWF and WCW. You guys were competing to be better products. Now it just seems like it's a war of words, and it's a, well, let's see who can make fun of the other guy more and who can reveal storylines.
I don't know if we're making fun of their product.
The Tony Schiavone incident saying don't change the channel because Mankind's going to win the title. He fought here as Cactus Jack. That won't put any butts in the seat. That was a little mean-spirited. I mean, Ally McBeal's on at the same time. Why don't you give the ending of Ally McBeal?
I think that
at the very least, let people know the length of her skirt.
Sure.
That's it, Gene?
That's it.
I was teeing you up, I thought for sure.
I'm not going to do it to you, Michael.
No?
No.
Okay.
I've insulted everybody. You just said that during the break.
I did. I was ticking off the groups that are probably insulted by it.
I got the Brits.
Right. You know, a little lesson for you. Mm-hmm. If they don't know they're insulted, don't tell them. All right, we'll take a break. You were talking about that. We should do that, and we should let you know that we'll do what you tell us to do. Put guests on first. You get Bret Hart, then Eric Bischoff, and now you score the granddaddy of them all, Goldberg. Goldie, your show is the best. Keep it up, you punk. I think they're referring to me as the punk. There's our website. There's our email. There's our fax number. I'm going to throw out some names from you guys, and I'd love for you to comment when we return. Desk. You know what you get on Sports Desk. You get all the news of the day. Sports Desk up next. And a couple of other things we got to tell you about on TSN. The ESPY Awards. Mark McGuire, you know what he's up for. 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 o'clock Pacific time. The ESPYs tonight on TSN. And also, we've got the Dave Hodge special with George Brett. I think one of the most intelligent and compelling characters in baseball from the 1980s. George Brett with Dave Hodge. 10 o'clock Eastern. What's up with you guys before I throw out some names?
Very quickly, we have put together a new long-term arrangement with the good folks at Air Canada Centre, which will be our venue exclusively for World Championship Wrestling. And it starts with Monday Nitro, live on the 29th of March. And I understand the facility is absolutely fabulous. We're looking forward to being one of the first live events there.
The Law, live audio wrestling, now heard on Real Radio, the Fan 590 Sports Radio in Toronto, Sunday nights from 1 to 2 in the morning.
All right, let's throw out some names for you guys. Jeff, feel free to jump in.
Sure.
For you, Goldberg, just give me one line, right? Stone Cold, give me a comment.
I admire him quite a bit. Very successful.
Gene, Jim Ross.
Good. I'm allowed one word.
No, you're allowed as many as you want.
Good.
You're going to stick to one word? I like that.
For a guy from Oklahoma, he's good.
Thanks.
I'm sorry about that. Jeez.
Kevin Nash.
Another good guy. Very successful. Smart.
Jesse the Body Ventura, Gene.
Honest. Honest. Matter of fact, he has communicated honesty to the citizens of my former state, Minnesota, and he captured the imagination of the voters there. Young voters.
Diamond Dallas Page.
Nice wife.
He works very, very hard at what he gets. So, he settles for second best.
Chris Jericho.
Oh, creative. Very creative young man.
You're not sticking to the one-word limit. So I'm going to have to just cut off this whole damn show and say, Bill Goldberg, thanks very much for joining us. Gene Okerlund, I'm going to throw impartiality out the window. You're one of my favorites. Jeff Merrick, we'll see you again Off the Record. Thanks for joining us today.
Off the Record with Michael Landsberg is brought to you by the Keg Steakhouse and Bar. For great steaks, good friends, see you tonight. Michael Landsberg's clothing, courtesy for you.
Saturn is in Chicago for this. You can't be good. Just a little humiliated wearing a dress around.
Ah.
Cross-dressing.